My next guest has been in exile for 2.5 years, fleeing Belarus to neighbouring Lithuania. And this week, the Belarusian opposition leader was handed a 15-year jail term in absentia for treason. And Svetlana, pronounce it for me.
Tikhanovskaya.
Tikhanovskaya is with me here in the studio. Thank you so much for joining us. We really do appreciate it. You have been sentenced to 15 years in absentia. Why are you not in your country? Tell us what happened in Belarus.
You know, in 2020, we had presidential elections. It was my husband who wanted to participate because he was supported by Belarusian people. But Lukashenko's regime jailed him because he dared to challenge Lukashenko.
Years. 18 years? Your
now
husband?
It's already 19 and a half years.
Wow.
And I stepped instead of my husband to show my love to him and to my country. And I was overwhelmingly supported by Belarusian people because Belarusian society want changes in Belarus. We, for 28 years, we have been lived under dictatorship, but we want democratic changes in the country. Since after the fraudulent elections, according to independent observers, I won the elections, but Lukashenko seized the power with the help of violence, and I had to flee Belarus because of repressions.
With the children?
With the children, yeah. And after fraudulent elections, huge, massive protests took place on the streets of Belarus. We wanted peacefully change this dictatorship system. But with the help of violence, with the help of support of Kremlin, Lukashenko managed to stay in power. And since then, for 2.5 years already, repressions haven't stopped for a day in our country. Every day, 17, 20 people are being detained for their political views. And now, not only those who are opposing the regime, but also those who are opposing the war and supporting Ukraine also became the enemies of the regime.
How concerned are you that talking out means that that could be detrimental for your husband?
No, of course, you know, people in Belarus, especially those who are in prisons under constant threat. There is no law in our country, and of course, people in prisons are humiliated constantly, physically and morally. They're being tortured. But I know that only when I'm loud, when I'm talking about Belarus, telling the world about human rights abuses in our country, about absence of law, this will be the chance to release all of them. And our people in Belarus and our political prisoners are very brave people. And even being behind the bars, you know, they are continuing the fight. They encourage us, don't stop. Don't think about us, think about Belarus and about our future.
What is day-to-day life like for you now? You have a bounty on your head now, 15 years behind bars. You have to, I think you're living in Lithuania at the moment. What is day-to-day life like for you and the children?
So first of all, I have to say that this sentence, you know, doesn't mean anything for me because it has nothing to deal with justice. I know that I have to continue the work we are doing to advocate for Belarus, to show the world, you know, humanitarian catastrophe in our country. And, you know, I try to spend as much time as possible in Lithuania, you know, seeing my children, communicating with Belarusians who are in Lithuania and Poland and in Belarus. But of course, a huge part of my job is to communicate with the political leaders of different countries, explaining what's going on in the country, how Belarus is connected with the war in Ukraine, to attract attention to our humanitarian problems and to raise awareness, actually, to show how Belarus is important for regional security. Because now I see that Belarus is a little bit overlooked because, you know, the war in Ukraine. But Belarus is part of this crisis, and the war cannot be over until Belarus is free.
What would you say to Lukashenko if you could speak to him?
No, I have nothing to say to him, but I'm sure that he understands that Belarusian society will never accept him anymore. And it's the best chance for him to live, peacefully live, and to let Belarus to develop in a European way.
When do you think you might be able to go home?
difficult to say. Nobody will say, you know, the concrete term, you know, when we will win this fight. But what I know is that every day I have to fight against dictatorship to do something that will bring this victory closer.
Okay, what do you want the British government to do to help you?
So first of all, I have to say that UK has already done so much for Belarusian people, for Belarusian civil society, and to create multiple points of pressure on the regime. I was here 1 year ago, and now I see that Belarus is, as I said, is overlooked because attention span is rather short, and I have to remind the UK government and parliament about Belarus. Though since 2020, this assistance pressure on Lukashenko's regime has never stopped, but this assistance is a little bit chaotic, so we need more systematic approach. And I see eagerness to help us, to be with the Belarusians. But I asked, for example, to synchronize all the sanctions against the regime with the European Union, to increase assistance to our media, to our human rights defending centers, to stay in solidarity with Belarus. It's very important because when I see that Belarusian people feel that they are forgotten, they are abandoned, they lose this energy to continue this fight. Now it's on the top, but we need the world's attention.
It's good to talk to you. Thank you for taking the opportunity to come and join us, and hopefully people will be listening to what you have to say. Thank you very much, Shinti. Good to see you. Thank you.